Hello again, welcome back, and great pleasure now to move towards Japan. I'm joined by Takeshi Kito, Vice Chair of the Japan Fintech Association, and we're going to talk about the transition to a digital economy. What are the consequences? Thank you for coming to Luxembourg.
Yeah, thank you for having me here.
I don't think it's your first time in Luxembourg.
It's the second time, but 15 years back.
It's great to have you here and your views from the Japanese side on the fintech market. First of all, thinking about the past few years, clients' behavior, customers' behavior has changed. We now look for a more interactive and participatory kind of relationship with banks. So thinking about a customer's relationship with banks, what have you observed?
Yes, similar to this region, the same thing is happening in Japan. And the banks and the financial institutions trying to change and transform their touch points. So some banks provide their own mobile application. And another banks are also trying to provide a banking as a service platform, which enable other non-financial companies or mobile applications to provide financial services. This is what I have seen in Japan.
And so comparing the Asian countries with European countries, just moving to the widespread look, we often think that Europeans are not moving as fast as the Asian companies, the researchers, and also America at times.
Yeah.
Do you think Asian countries are much more advanced than European countries when it comes to fintech?
It depends on the countries. So, for example, China is doing a lot of things. It's driven by the government. But in Japan, we do not have strong power in the government. And another point is European countries are very well connected each other. And in the financial industry, there is a passporting framework in this region. So if banks and financial institutions have a license in one country, they can do some operations in other countries. But in Japan or in Asian countries, we don't have that kind of framework, so we need a license in each country, so we are not well connected yet.
And when it comes to thinking about the Asian countries, you've mentioned the comparison to China and how that's very much more government-led in its choices and decisions. I can also think about South Korea, for example, where I think they're going to have a cashless society rather soon and also a metaverse by 2030 or something like this. So there are some Asian countries that I can really pinpoint to think they are so digitally advanced. Mm-hmm. Where do you look to? Where do young Japanese people look to when they think about countries that are really advanced in terms of the way they live digitally and the Internet of Things and anything to do with the technology landscape?
Right. It actually depends on the verticals or technologies. But Japanese government and Japanese fintech community is trying to be more digitized and trying to be the best place in terms of digitalization or fintech in the Asia, in the region. But to be honest, Singapore is doing very well in the fintech industry.
And what was it that made you want to work in fintech specifically?
Sorry.
Why did you want to work in fintech specifically? Why did that grab you of all of the regions of digitalization? Why fintech?
What fintech? Yes, I think fintech covers very broad society and industries. So a couple of years ago, fintech is only for financial industry. But recently, the responsibility of the fintech is expanding. So one thing I'd like to mention is data trading or establishing a data marketplaces. There is a lot of things for fintech companies and the fintech industry to do, because data-related transaction is sometimes developed with the analogy of a financial industry. So that is the reason why I am focusing on the fintech and the financial industry.
And then just thinking with what's happening in Ukraine at the moment, and when we think about a digital world, we think about everything being global, everything being constantly engaged around the world globally. But specifically with what's happening with Ukraine, we now feel that things should be very secure within the country we are in. So when it comes to the world that you live in, which is fintech, how do you perceive the world of fintech within Japan, and how global do you want to become?
Yes, it's a very difficult question. And actually, Japanese government is recently very keen to establish a national security framework, and also some trying to do some economic statecraft. But as an entrepreneur, I want to pursue the being, let's say, globally, because one of the biggest agenda in the fintech industry is financial inclusion, and we have to be more inclusive. So we need to more global, keep this kind of global ecosystem. And personally, I am supporting Ukraine ecosystem, and I am mentoring startups who is trying to provide solutions to recover Ukraine economy and ecosystem.
That's really wonderful work and very worthy work as well. Yeah. Now, fintech financial technology covers such a widespread range of companies, from small startups to more traditional banks that are trying to completely shift the way they're working. Can you give us any examples, your favorite examples of some banks or some startups?
Yes. In Japan, banks still has strong power, and we have to collaborate with banks. So one example, one bank is that I think they're doing well, which is MUFG, Mitsubishi UFJ Financial Group, and they provide a fast accelerator program for fintech companies, and they are very proactively investing in international fintech companies. And also current CEO has a digital and innovation background, so banks are also trying to transform, to adapt to fintech technologies and other innovations.
Takeshi, thank you so much for coming to ICT Spring here in Luxembourg, and thank you for your time talking to us about everything that's happening with your work, your world of fintech from Japan.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.